Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Forest Hill Presbyterian Church. A few announcements to be made. This is Holy Week, so as such, we are preparing for additional services this week. The Monday Thursday service will be held at 6 p.m. A reminder that it will be a service that includes the practice of foot washing. So, you know, I think about things like that today. It's not a good day to wear pantyhose. the tights that I'm wearing today, not a good day for foot washing. So be prepared to make it as easy as possible for yourself so it would be comfortable to be able to have your feet washed as part of that service. Also, we'll have our Good Friday service at noon on Good Friday, this Friday. And it is a very somber tone. It's a reading of the full passion story from John's Gospel. So it's a very meditative kind of service. So come in that spirit to listen to that story so that we can be prepared for the transformation that happens on Easter morning. Easter morning, we will be not having Sunday school, but there will be an Easter breakfast here at 9 a.m. So come for breakfast, stay for the service. Invite your friends, because Easter is a celebration of all that is true about God's love for us. So keep those things in mind as we prepare for Holy Week. The week after Holy Week, I will be taking a week of vacation, and then Mary Jane will be preaching here the first Sunday in April. So you can all can welcome her back to this pulpit. I know she's a familiar face and a welcome voice here at Forest Hill. So And also Martha Nicholas is at Johnson Willis Hospital and just recently had surgery. I know a couple of folks have gone to see her and check in on her, and I'll do that myself this afternoon. Are there any other folks to remember today too? Then let us worship God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you.
Triumphant and victorious is he.
Humble and riding on a donkey.
On a colt.
The foal of a donkey. Our first hymn today for Palm Sunday is hymn number 196, All Glory, Laud, and Honor. Confidence in God's redeeming love, let us together confess our sins.
Christ to seek and save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your way. We are misled by pride, for we see ourselves pure when we are stained and great when we are small. We have failed in love, neglected justice, and ignored your truth. Have mercy, O God, and forgive our sin. Return us to paths of righteousness through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Thank you that you are answering my will answer me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Then the festal procession with branches up to the horns and the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord for his good, for his steadfast love endures forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm that we are singing today is Psalm 31, which will be found hymn number 214 in the red hymnal. You are my refuge, faithful God. Hangs together. So hear God's word to us through Mark 11:1-11. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing, untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks along the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. Jesus knew this scripture verse. Matthew and Mark were familiar with Jesus' use of this scripture verse, and it is part of today's longer version of the story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. We read from Mark today, but Matthew and Mark share the same sequence of events that happen when Jesus sets his mind to confront the authorities in Jerusalem. On Palm Sunday, we tend to focus on the parade alone. There are the palm branches waving, the coats thrown on the ground, children and adults singing Hosanna, and maybe even a few rocks that would sing God's praise if the human voices were silent. It is a stunning image with an ironic twist. Jesus is coming into Jerusalem on a humble colt of a donkey, not the grand steed of the Roman soldier. Jesus is hearing chanting from the crowd that he is the one who will restore the Davidic kingdom, which disrupts the authority of the priestly Pharisees who believe themselves to be the only legitimate authority in the Jerusalem temple. This parade alone is scandalous. But what happens next is a series of events and parables naming the kind of disruption Jesus is stirring up. He goes to Jerusalem with an agenda, remember? Morally and ethically, Jesus may be sinless, but what he does with intent in Jerusalem will provoke the authorities of both the church and the state against him. Mark's version of the story has Jesus going back and forth between Bethany, where his friends were, and Jerusalem, where his enemies are. Jesus probably needed the sustenance of time with friends to be able to continue with his plan. So after the parade, Jesus goes to the temple, but as it's getting late, they walk back to Bethany. The day after that palm parade, Jesus curses a fig tree on his walk back because he was hungry and the fig tree had no fruit on it. He didn't get any breakfast that day. After that, and maybe still a little bit hangry, Jesus goes to the temple and flips the tables of the money changers. From the Palm Sunday parade to the tables of the money changers. That's a sequence that we need to remember and know. Then on their way back to Bethany that evening, they pass the same fig tree that Jesus cursed for having no figs on it. And it is withered up and died. That's when Jesus tells his disciples to have faith in God, that if they have even a little bit of faith, that they can up and move mountains into the sea. So Jesus tells them, whatever you ask for in prayer, if you believe it, you will receive it. He also tells them that the less returned to the temple again. The chief priests, elders, and scribes come up to Jesus and ask him, not in a nice way, by whose authority are you doing these things? That's an accusation, not a question, by the way. They even argued among themselves as to who Jesus was and what his presence could possibly mean in Jerusalem. In addition to being a preacher, teacher, and healer, Jesus was a highly agitating figure among those who thought themselves powerful. But even in this hostile environment, Jesus turns to teaching. He teaches in parables. He has more confrontations with the Pharisees. He's raising eyebrows and creating friction everywhere he goes. So in both Mark and Matthew, at the height of the confrontation, Jesus tells the parable of the wicked tenants. I'll refresh your memory. In this parable, the owner of a vineyard built out his property with a fence around the vines, a pit for the wine press, and even a watchtower. Then he leases it to tenants to care for it. When the time comes for the owner of the property to get his share of the wine, he sends a slave to go collect it. That slave is then beaten by the tenants and returned to the owner empty-handed. They're trying to hoard everything they have for themselves. So the owner sends a second slave. That one gets beaten over his head and insulted. The third slave, outright killed. So then the vineyard owner contemplates a bit and says, I think I'll send my beloved son, thinking that he will be respected so much more so than the servants that have been sent. You know this isn't the case, right? They kill the heir, thinking the vineyard will then belong to them. It is a story of the terrible greed and cruelty that humans are capable of. And it's a reminder that if we don't take care of what has been given to us with generosity towards God and others, the vineyard owner will come and give everything we have to someone else. Which is precisely when Jesus quotes this verse from Psalm 118. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. Jesus is both beloved son and rejected stone. Jesus is the one who will save us, and he is the one who will crucify. Jesus is rock solid as the one we should trust upon to build our foundation on top of, and yet we set him aside, instead welcoming worldly powers that crumble far more easily. It's easy for us to focus on the story of the parade and miss the other details of how the gospel writers intend for us to understand this story. The whole of Psalm 118 is about the festal parade. Jesus knows about it and uses it to set up a public protest. In the psalm, people are waving their palms, headed towards the altar of the Lord with praise and thanksgiving. They are naming the one who is blessed in the name of the Lord. Remember that Jesus is the promise that God's steadfast love will endure for all times, which is the main refrain of this prayer. God's steadfast love endures forever. And then Israel says, God's steadfast love endures forever. Jesus comes to Jerusalem to demonstrate to the faith leaders what they have forgotten. They have become too powerful, too rigid, too concerned about their own rites and rituals to recognize the love of God. They were also too close to the Roman authorities, doing whatever they needed to do to stay out of trouble with what the empire wanted of them. The parade that the Pharisees and scribes and priests would have heard about was exactly as it is described in this psalm. Hosannas, shouts for salvation, the day of the Lord that would have filled the onlookers with love and devotion towards God because of what they see in Jesus Christ. Jesus is counting on them to know the reference when he then gets into the argument with the Pharisees and scribes and priests about authority. Jesus tells them, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is not a subtle statement. This quote has meaning and context, and it's a powerful use of scripture. He's saying this about their rejection of him, and it has to sting. It's guaranteed to provoke their anger. They were the builders. Jesus is calling himself the cornerstone, the rock, God's son and beloved heir. And he knows that they want him dead. Then Jesus completes the verse. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. Jesus claims his authority, but not in the way that they're trying to trap him. He claims that he is the fulfillment not only of the law, but as will be said of Christ later, but Jesus is also the fulfillment of God's love, the steadfast love that endures forever. He is the chief cornerstone of that promise, but that promise will take him on a hard road of pain and persecution. The festal parade as the entry into Jerusalem marks Jesus as hostile to the way things are by promising to his followers how things could be in the light of God's love. To read the whole story from the parade to Jesus applying the verse about the chief cornerstone to himself gives us a much broader picture of Jesus' intent. Over the rest of this week, we will follow Jesus on the journey of how this plays out through Jesus' rejection, trial, humiliation, and execution. Good Friday is also a bleak Friday when it seems as though the power of this love will be lost. To know that Jesus is inciting this argument, to know the depth of his pain in doing so, is important. For it is only in contrast to that sorrow of having to confront the religion he knew as his connection to God, that's when you begin to see the incredible jubilation of Easter morning. This week we journey with Jesus into Jerusalem, the city that kills its prophets and stones those who are sent to save it. I hope that you will ponder that particular scripture verse, the one that anchors Jesus in his public protest. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. It is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Amen. Our next hymn is hymn number 215 in the red hymnal, What Wondrous Love Is This.
Thank you.
God, you give us everything we need to survive. You give us joy so that we can thrive as well. Be with us as we offer these gifts of thanksgiving, these gifts of praise, so that they might be used to do your work in the world. In Jesus' name I pray. Your steadfast love, O God, endures forever. Even in those times that we might struggle to trust you, O God, we say those words knowing that we can. We can trust you. We can trust your love to be true and for us always. And yet we find ourselves putting our trust in other things, in the ways that we have known, in the resources that we have, in the powers that we've come to consider permanent. And yet you give us reason to open our eyes and change our ways, to see the festal parade as a challenge to the way things are, so that we might know how things could be. Remind us that we could be celebrating Jesus and his love every single day, that we can be shouting Hosanna, knowing our salvation, that we can be reminded that all good things come through you, and that when difficult things happen, you are there with us. We pray for your blessing on this Holy Week, that we may find ourselves in reflection on this story and the passion of Jesus, reminding ourselves that his suffering was not in vain, but so that we might know the glory that was about to be revealed in everlasting life. Take us on that journey with Jesus. Fill us with the Spirit as we read Scripture, as we pray, as we come together as a community, so that we may be your people. We pray for those who are sick and in the hospital. We pray for those who struggle with the daily things of life, whether that's because of loneliness or anxiety or depression or chronic conditions or headaches or simply the frustration of things not going the way we had hoped. Be with us in our prayers. Be with us in our joys as well, so that we might celebrate the small things of life, the purple flowers poking their heads up through even the trees along the streets, even as they make us sneeze. Help us to be reminded that spring is coming and newness is around us everywhere. We pray to you, O God, with the prayers of my mouth and the prayers of all of our hearts. So hear us in a time of silent reflection. join me as we lift our voices praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our closing hymn is hymn number 221, O Sacred Head Now Wounded. Spirit be with you this day and always. Amen.